Hush now, my baby, be still, love, don't cry. Sleep as you're rocked by the stream. Sleep and remember my last lullaby. So I'll be with you when you
Well, that was a clip from the movie The Prince of Egypt from 1998. Maybe you remember the movie. I sure do. Really excellent movie. Stands the test of time so far. And especially that soundtrack. That soundtrack's really, really great. Now, Moses was a baby in this clip that we just saw. But he grows up to be a powerful leader, a powerful kingdom of God builder that starts a nation and frees his people. And so we're calling this sermon series Moses, Finding God in the Journey. Because there's this journey that we're all on. It's like an adventure. We're going places and we actually can't really even see exactly how it's going to work out. Goodness knows, with Moses' life, no one would have guessed how it was all going to turn out and how God led them. And so we're going to find God in the journey. We're on a journey. We're on an adventure. You and me together. And God wants to show us himself. He wants to show us how to live life and how to go through life his ways, the kingdom ways, and not our own ways. So this sermon series, we're going to go through the entire life of Moses. It's going to last about 17 weeks. It's our summer series. And we're going to see how this journey of Moses actually then represents and has a lot of things that we can apply to our own lives and our own journey. So I got a question for you. Do you know someone who has really inspired your faith? You look at their life and you think, wow, man, their faith, their walk with God, their prayer life, just like, wow, it's really inspiring to me. You know, several different Christians, famous Christians, inspire me. Billy Graham, his life of integrity and his love for reaching people for the gospel. Oral Roberts and his faith, and, you know, Charles and John Wesley and their devotion and dedication and how God used them in such special ways. Or even Charles Spurgeon. He was a preacher in the mid-1800s, and his sermons were so good that the London Times printed them on Monday, printed them out like a transcript of them so that other people could get him in their heart. You know, I find those guys inspiring. You're probably thinking of people too in your life, right? That inspire your faith. They keep pushing through. They keep going with God, and it's like, wow, they've had every opportunity to quit, but they just never did. I'm inspired by my parents. You know, they were here in Indiana, and that's where they were born and raised, but God got a hold of their life. My dad then went to study for the ministry in Oklahoma, moved back here to their hometown, started a church in 1987. The church did well. Now that church is known as Church of the Heartland, and we have 7 locations and about 1,000 people on any given Sunday. And all of that was just faith. My parents trusting God, pushing forward. With all kinds of opportunities to quit, they never quit. I'm inspired by my friend, Ray Humphrey. She has been given a diagnosis that's very, very difficult, cancer diagnosis. But in the midst of staring that cancer in the face, she just keeps serving God, and she trusts God, and she's keep taking steps. Every time I talk to her, I'm inspired by her and her faith. I'm inspired by Chris Miller, the pastor of our Plymouth location. She is something. And, you know, she had a really rough time kind of getting started in her younger years. But as God, she got saved, as God began to do stuff in her life, she's just done so very much. And every single situation she's been through, she keeps drilling down into the Lord and getting closer to the Lord in the middle of that trial. And that has created a powerful woman of faith. As I watched her go through those trials and stuff, I just just think, wow, you just keep pushing forward and doing the right things in the middle of difficult situations. So this sermon series through the life of Moses, it's going to definitely challenge our faith. We're going to be challenged and we're going to be inspired. The way that Moses acted and reacted to different things is a great model for our lives. Moses faced situation after situation, and every single time he obeyed God, he followed God, and I think there's a lot of things we can learn from that. Now, first, let's take a moment and look at the world that Moses was born into. Let's look at some historical background. Now, to do this right, we got to understand this background here together. So Moses was a Jew, an Israelite, born in Egypt. Now Egypt is this has like two strips of land on the side of the Nile River, and it was surrounded by a vast desert, but the Nile would flood at times and overflow its banks, and that would be used as the water to water the fields, even though the rain was, it's a desert, so it wasn't much rain at all. Now the story of Moses, it starts in the book of Exodus. And so Exodus is a unique book because it really has no beginning and no end. And it starts actually as a continuation of the book of Genesis. Now, the book of Exodus tells us the story of 3,500 years ago. Okay, think about that. That's 2,000 years ago is with Jesus. So another 1,500 years before that. And these Israelites are enslaved in Egypt, the whole nation of them. But what led to that? What led to their enslavement? Because when we look at the last part of Genesis, what happened between Genesis, the first book of the Bible, and Exodus, the second book of the Bible? Well, we go back to Genesis, and we have the story of Abraham. Once we get past some of the creation and stuff, we get the story of Abraham and his son Isaac and his grandson Jacob. And then Jacob has 12 sons himself. So we have like father, grandfather, grandson, and then great-grandsons. One of those great-grandsons was Joseph. One of those 12 brothers was Joseph. Now Joseph was, it's a great story in the last part of Genesis. He was betrayed by his brother, sold into slavery, and he was sold to Egypt, even though they lived in what's modern day Israel, but it was called Canaan at the time. Now God used Joseph though, even though he was sold into slavery, God used him to save that nation from famine. He became the prime minister of the nation, like the second in command, basically, of the whole country. And so he's this very influential player. Joseph then gets his whole family, there's 70 of them, his 12 brothers and sisters, 11 brothers and sisters and their families and his dad, move down to Egypt to live there and be taken care of in the middle of this famine. Okay, now, that's the end of the book of Genesis. Fast forward to the first chapter of Exodus, it is 350 years later. Now, in that 350 years, Joseph and all he did was forgotten. And the people, those 70 Jews, have now multiplied and multiplied and multiplied. That family now, that Jewish group, the Israelites, are over 2 million people. You know, they are, they're still outnumbered by the Egyptians, but there's millions and millions of them. Now, with that kind of population growth, it makes people nervous, and it made the Pharaoh nervous. So the Pharaoh began to persecute. First, the Pharaohs before began to persecute the Jews, kind of put them down. Well, that didn't stop it. And then as new Pharaohs came about, they each took a harsher approach to the Jews, to the one point where they just enslaved them. They said with spears in hand, you're working for us. You're not a citizen anymore. You're a slave. And upon doing that, then the Israelites began to be, just born into that slavery. So at the beginning of the book of Exodus, we have millions of enslaved Israelites living in this foreign land of Egypt. They're not living in Canaan. And then the Pharaoh then goes on not just to enslave them. He's still trying to cut down the population. So what he does is he decrees that all the young boys, Jewish boys, be murdered. Babies be murdered, and some by stabbing, and most by being thrown into the Nile River and drowned. It's horrible. So this is the world that Moses was born into. So, of course, this series is going to be about Moses, but we're going to talk a lot about his parents today. His parents were named Amram was his father, and Jochebed, that's a hard word to say, Jochebed his mother. So we're going to go to now Exodus chapter 2 and look at verse 1. It says, about this time, a man, that is Amram, and a woman, Jochebed, were from the tribe of Levi. They got married. So the woman, verse 2, became pregnant and gave birth to a son. She saw that he was special. The son would be Moses. She saw that he was special, a special baby, and kept him hidden for 3 months. Okay, she was not supposed to have this child. So she keeps this baby hidden from the Egyptian authorities as best as she can. I mean, imagine how difficult that would be. Now, let's look at this. Because if we let them, hard times, guys, can develop our faith. Hebrews 11:23, by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents. It was faith that had his parents hiding that baby Moses. They said, I trust God. Faith is trusting God, right? Now, we all go through hard times. It happens to every one of us. And those hard times, they can develop our faith if we let them. We have to let them develop our faith. And if we give it to God, that process, if we give it to God in the process, God can actually use those processes. Now, if you're over the age of 40, like I am, you probably had grandparents or maybe great-grandparents that went through the Great Depression, and you might have heard their stories of what that was like. I mean, the Great Depression, you know, the whole world went through that economic issue, but America was hit really hard. They were trying to save as much food as they could. There's so many stories about people not finding work, being in those bread lines, stories from our parents and grandparents and great-grandparents where they had just a little bit of food and they'd feed their kids. And then they'd scrape all the food from the kids' plates together and try to make some meal for themselves. I mean, it was a pretty difficult time in America's history, right? And as hard as it was to live through that Great Depression time, that what Moses' parents were living through was so much worse. I mean, it's unthinkable. Moses was born into slavery. Imagine finding out you're expecting a child and you knew that there's a 50-50 chance of whether it's a boy or a girl, whether that child will be murdered. See, the Israelites had been in Egypt for now 350 years. So they had to be, that threat had to be dealt with. They were killing those babies off. And Pharaoh basically deputized all of Egypt to kill those little baby boys, Hebrew children boys, and throw them into the Nile River. Now, so let's just say it this way. That's a really difficult situation that Amram and Jochebed were in. Very difficult. And now when we're put into difficult situations, we have a couple choices. Really, one, we can be overcome by the fear of that moment. What are we going to do? And just be overwhelmed by the fear, let the fear take over us. Or number two, we can learn to lean into God and learn to trust Him like never before. Those are really the options for us as believers. We're going to give into fear or lean and press into God. And Moses' parents were in this terrible situation, but what did they do? They leaned into God. They said, we got this special baby. This is a special thing God's given us. I got to trust God like never before. And so Amram and Jochebed trusted God and pushed into their relationship with God. Now, guys, you might be going through a hard time. I don't know. You might be in a situation where you have to decide what to do. Are you going to give in to fear and all the things that fear entails and just kind of surrender to the overwhelming fear over your life? Or are you going to push into God? Because we can grow if we learn to push into God and to trust God when these hard, difficult times come. Well, we see how Moses' parents took that first step of faith, right? Of hiding Moses, but after 3 months, they had another level of faith that they had to come up to, and we see that in Exodus 2:3. When she could no longer hide him, she got a basket made of papyrus reeds and waterproofed it with tar and pitch. She put the baby in the basket and laid it among the reeds among the bank of the Nile River. All right, let's let that verse sink into our hearts just a little bit. This baby, God says, hold on to this child. It's a special child. She hides it. She can no longer hide this baby. She doesn't know what to do. So What does God say to do? Take this baby, put it in a reed basket, pitch with tar, make sure it's floatable, and put it in the Nile. Now the Nile's where they're killing all the babies. I mean, it's not just any place. She's told to put that baby in the most dangerous place you could possibly put a baby at this time, the Nile River. They were asked to let go of something that they would have had a very hard time letting go of. But God was saying, it's time to let go. Time to let go of what you're holding on to, even at the risk of Moses dying. Guys, sometimes it's easier for us to trust God when we don't have to let go. But you know what I've found? We can't grab the new thing that God's got for our life without letting go of the old thing. There's going to only be one thing in our hands, and we've got to let go so God can put the new thing in our hands. And for Moses, his life, Amram and Jochebed had to let go and say, okay, God, I trust you with my son. Even in this terrible situation, I trust you with my son. And then now, see, God can do something very special back into their life. Just recently, I had to kind of trust God with my daughter Mia's education. She's still in high school. She's been homeschooled most of her life. And we felt, Missy and I together, felt that God wanted us to put her in solo college early and do, even though she's a high schooler, do college courses as a high schooler. Now that's a huge transition for her. You know, she's 16 years old. How's that going to work? But guess what? Just got done with her grades. Just got her grades back. She's got a 3.8 GPA for the semester and about that for the year. And all of that was just us saying, okay, God, here we go. Here's my daughter. Sometimes I felt like I might be throwing her to the wolves, but she did really good. And it seems like, here's how it happens. We feel like, okay, I'm trusting you, God. Okay. And then it's like, and we do the thing. For Moses, for Moses' parents, it was hiding him. All right, I got that. I did it. And God says, now it's time to take it to another level. It's like, oh, man. Am I gonna trust God with the different levels that he keeps asking us to grow in faith, to grow in trust with him? It's like we get comfortable at one place and God says, no, you got to go to this next place. And it's like, okay, Lord, I trust you in this. Now, in the story of Moses, he was launched out into that river, right? And that none other, he's sailing around, he's going down the river, and none other than the daughter of Pharaoh trying to kill Moses, the Pharaoh that was trying to kill Moses, his daughter sees that baby on the banks of the river, discovers him in the basket. She sees him and grabs up the baby. The baby, you know, immediately her heart just melts. She thinks this is awesome. She adopts this little baby as her own. And then Moses' sister Miriam was watching from the side, like seeing what's going to happen to her baby brother. She sees that the baby goes right into the palace where they're, you know, the ocean, the riverfront palace there. And so Miriam, the older sister, says, hey, do you want me to find a Hebrew mother to come and be the caretaker for this baby? Yeah, the princess, that's a great idea. So Miriam goes back, gets her own mother, and brings her own mother back. Jochebed becomes the caretaker of Moses. And what an incredible opportunity, right? I mean, that leads us to this important point right here. There's something better waiting for us after we let go. Exodus 2:9. Take this baby and nurse him for me, the princess told the baby's mother. I will pay you for your help. So Jochebed gets to take care of baby Moses. He's safe. He's now being raised as a prince of Egypt. And not only that, she gets paid to do it. I mean, that is awesome. What a miracle. There is no way Jochebed could have guessed that this situation would have turned out so amazing. She has this baby. I don't know what to do. She just gives it to the Lord. She trusts God. And God does something so much better than she could have ever imagined. Now, releasing Moses into the Nile was probably the hardest thing she's ever done. I mean, I couldn't imagine being placed in that situation myself. Trusting God like that. Here you go, Lord. But every time we obey God, there's something better waiting for us at the other end of that. Every obedience to God, we think we're losing things when we obey God. I'm going to lose this. No, there's something good on the other side of this. There's something big, some blessing on the other side of the obedience. When God tells us to let go and to trust Him, we've got to let go and trust Him because something better is in store for us. It's like amazing that they got to raise Moses. And now it would have been probably 10 to 12 years old. She would have been his caretaker. And what would she have been doing? She would have been putting God in the hearts of Moses. Here is the real God, Jehovah, the real God, not those false Egyptian gods. And this is your real brother. This is your real sister. He would have had connections with them. I'm your real mom, but you're being taken care of. I mean, she would have been able to put this crucial stuff into Moses' life and really shape the person he was going to become right there. And all of that was because she let go and she obeyed God and she trusted God even when it wasn't very easy. Now, of course, Moses had some amazing parents, but Moses had to decide for himself if he was going to follow God, right? You see, we all have faced different tests of faith. Exodus 2:10, later his mother brought him back to Pharaoh's daughter who adopted him as her own son. So the real test of faith here for Moses was very different than Amram and Jochebed's test. Amram and Jochebed had to surrender their son. They had to hide him and then surrender their child. Now for Moses, he's got it going on. He's part of this royal family of the most powerful nation on earth. And historians believe that this Pharaoh at the time, would have been probably childless, and that his daughter Thermutis was childless. So basically there was no male heir to be the Pharaoh. The Pharaoh would have had his daughter, but he didn't have any male heirs. And so basically that means Moses was being groomed as the successor, as the person to take the throne. Now that's a test. What are you going to do? Are you going to serve God, the true living God, Jehovah, who your mom has told you about? Or are you going to live as a God king and have people worship you and have everything you possibly could have ever wanted at your fingertips? I mean, Moses was educated with the wisdom of Egypt, and he had all these leadership qualities in his life. He would have been the likely person to be the next Pharaoh. Now that's a test, a very different test than Moses' parents. Moses' parents would have been a test of whether they could make it or not, death and slavery. But Moses' test was wealth and power and comfort. And that's the thing, all of our tests are different. The test of faith, are we going to serve the Lord? Are we going to put God first? We don't know a lot about the childhood of Moses, but we do know this. Somewhere along the lines, by the age of 40, he had decided that he was not going to be the prince of Egypt, that he was an Israelite, and that's who he truly, he embraced the real identity of serving God. Hebrews 11 even says that in verse 24 through 26. It says, by faith, Moses, so it was by faith, by trusting God, Moses grew up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He said, I will not do that. That's not the person I am. Instead, it says he chose to share the oppression of God's people instead of the fleeting pleasures of sin. He said, I'm instead going to let go of all the wealth of Egypt and I'm going to serve God instead. And that sounds familiar to the story of William Borden. And if that name sounds familiar, it's because it's from the Borden Dairy. You see the little logo here. Borden Dairy, which was at the time of William Borden in the 1800s, a million-dollar company. Now it's worth $2 billion today. And against all worldly logic, William forsake millions of his family's money, the inheritance, to follow the call of God on his life. He began to attend Yale University. And in his freshman year there, he began this prayer meeting with him and another guy early in the morning. And some other students then started to join them, then some more. And soon the report of that prayer meeting and what God was doing began to grow. And by the end of the first year, William Borden has 150 students gathering for his prayer meetings across campus. By the end of his senior year, 4 years later, there were over 1,000 students going to William Borden's prayer meetings. During his college years, William founded this thing called Yale Hope Mission, And the mission was to help alcoholics and people that were just, you know, addicted to alcohol and other things, and to help them and their families. And he would take parts, whatever he could get from his family fortune, and then use it to fund this mission that helped people overcome addictions. And William himself was the real deal. He would often be found near the docks, just feeding people, giving sandwiches away, and sharing the good news of Jesus with them. Now, William Borden had a choice to make, and it would have been a difficult one, right? You can sit in the lap of luxury, never have to work, never have to do anything, just sit there and enjoy your inheritance money, or you can serve the Lord. And what did he do? He served the Lord. While at school, he started to serve God. He started these prayer meetings. He was the real deal, out on those ship docks, feeding hurting people, helping addicts overcome. I mean, what a testimony of letting go of the comfort that comes along with worldly things and grabbing instead the bigger thing of changing lives, transforming lives. Now, we may not have the temptation of $1 billion sitting at our beck and call, and our temptations might be different. But God's going to ask every single one of us to let go of something. There are things we have to let go of. There are things we've got to trust into the hands of God. It might not be a palace. We might be more Amram and Jochebed, and then we are, you know, William Borden and Moses. But there are tests to our faith that we need to pass where God says, hand this over to me, and you trust me, and I'm going to make everything turn out okay. You see, we each have a choice to make. Will we choose what God says is important? Or we choose what the world says is important? We got a choice. We really, even if we have some of those earthly things, okay, that's good. But are we going to let that be what we're about? No, we cannot. We have to take that same spirit that Moses had, where he chose to break out of the comfort of Egypt and say, no, I want God to use me. I don't want the sins of Egypt when I can have God. Moses chose hardship over comfort. He chose shame with the slaves instead of fame with the Egyptians. He chose the wilderness over the palace. Moses' parents had a choice to make too. Are we going to trust God with this child? Here we go. Okay, we're going to hide him. Now we're going to give him to the river. What is this? How does this work? We all have choices to make. There are all things where our faith is being tested. And are we going to step out in faith and trust God? Say, God, all right, I don't understand what you're doing. I don't know what this looks like, but I know you're good, and I'm handing this over to you. You see, the closer we get to God, the more we realize that the things of this world really have lost their shine and luster. The world doesn't have anything to offer us anymore. But God's kingdom, serving God, knowing God, now that is where the real value lies. So, how do we apply this to our lives? Two things. Number one, lean into trusting God when times get hard. Guys, times are going to get hard. They might be hard for you right now. Lean into trusting God. Say, all right, God, here I am. I'm in this difficult place. Man, I want to just do it my own way, but I'm going to do it your way instead. And lean into God. Most people, when times get tough, they bolt. They don't go to church anymore. Stop reading their Bible. Stop praying. They just kind of bolt. No, let's be those who push into the things of God when times get tough. And number two, trust God when he tells you to let go. Trust him. Guys, you will be asked to let go of things. I mean, one of the things that God's doing in our hearts is he's creating disciples. And that means he will ask, these relationships, are you going to let them go and trust me? This money, are you going to let it go and trust me? Your career, are you going to let it go and trust me? Even in with your health. And I mean, that's what he's going to ask for these things, because that's what being a disciple is about. Letting go, fully committed. And so we got to learn to trust God when he tells us to let go. That everything on the other end, on the backside of this trust, everything will be better than it even is right now. Let's pray together. Let's have a word of prayer together. Lord, I pray right now for every one of us that's going through a hard time here today. Lord, they're in difficult situations. Lord, I pray that you help us to lean into you and you give us the strength to lean into you in these hard times. Lord, there's a lot of voices in the wind. Help us to focus on your voice and to hear your voice and obey your voice. Lord, I pray for clarity in the next step to take so we can obey you. I pray for the strength to obey. I pray for the strength for each of us in the letting go process. Give us the strength to let go and put that peace upon our life, the peace that passes all understanding. Lay that over our lives in Jesus' name. Amen.